Howdy folks, welcome back to World of Tanks with the mighty Jingles. I hope you had a good Christmas, and if you don't celebrate Christmas, I hope you had a good Thursday. You know, we're non-discriminatory around here. I did say that during the course of my time off between Christmas and New Year, there were going to be the occasional videos getting uploaded, and this is one of them. And it's been a while since we did a tank review, so that's what you're getting today. And that is the brand new premium Panther with the 88mm gun. And that, in fact, is exactly what they've called it, the Panther with the 88. They really didn't spend an awful lot of time thinking about what to call this. Oh, we redesigned the Panther to use the 88mm gun from the Tiger II. Oh, what are we going to call it? Call it the Panther with the 88. It works for me. How very German of them. So, you want to know, is this thing worth spending any money on? Because this is, it's not a cheap tank. It's a tier 8 premium. This thing, available at the moment in the gift shop only. You cannot buy it in the in-game tech tree. And it costs roughly in the region of £32. And just to put that into perspective for you, that is the equivalent of spending money buying 6 months of premium time. So it's a not insubstantial purchase. Is it worth spending money on? Well, difficult to say. On paper, you look at this thing and you'd think, no way. it's not worth the money. Why do you say that? Well, it's basically a tier 7 Panther that gets tier 10 matchmaking. The only thing, in fact, it's not even as good as the tier 7 Panther. It's a really, really weird combination of stats. What you have is a tank that is the same as the tier 7 Panther medium tank, except not quite as good. If you can believe that. Hold on, I'm not done. With the gun from the tier 8 medium tank over here, the Panther 2's gun, except the gun on the Panther 88 is better than the gun on the Panther 2, despite the chassis, you know, the actual tank that the gun is fitted to, isn't as good as the tier 7 Panther. It's the most bizarre combination of stats I think I've ever seen on a tank. And I do like it, even though I'm hesitant to say it's a good tank. It's not a particularly good tank, but it does have a fantastic gun. Allow me to elaborate. I'll show you the sort of thing I'm talking about. Here's the stats for the Panther. Your basic Panther stats. And there's the stats for the Panther 88. We'll keep that in the middle. And here's the Panther 2. So, what are the differences? Well, put the Panther 2 to the side for the moment and get a load of this. Comparing the Panther 88 to the tier 7 Panther, it has more health because it's tier 8. It's got 200 more hit points, so it's got a total of 1500, same as the Panther 2. It's a good amount of hit points. It's slightly heavier than the Panther, and it has 100 horsepower less in the engine, so it has a worse power to weight ratio. Specific power of 12.78, whereas the Panther has 15.35. Okay. It's also slower, substantially slower. It's got a top speed of 46 kilometers per hour versus the Panther's 55. It is more maneuverable, however. Quite a bit more maneuverable, actually. The Panther turns at 32 degrees per second. The Panther 88 turns at 38. The armor is actually worse. If you can get your head around that for a second. The armor is actually not much worse, but it's worse than the Panther's armor. The Panther has 85mm of hull armor at the front. The Panther 88 only has 80. In all other respects, it's the same. Terrible 50mm of side armor, terrible 40mm of rear armor, and exactly the same turret, the Schmalturm, with 120 at the front and 60 at the sides and rear. The turret also turns slightly faster on the Panther 88 than on the Panther. 32 versus 30 degrees per second. It's got 10 meters better view range, but it's got terrible 550 meter signal range. The tank itself, in all respects, other than the traverse speed is worse than the Panther one tier lower. It's a bit of a disaster. However, let's compare it to the Panther 2. Now it has the same health, it's a lighter tank, but it doesn't have as powerful an engine. So, once again, power to weight ratio of the Panther 88 is 12.78. The power to weight ratio of the Panther 2 is 12.87. So there's not much difference in it. 12.78, 12.87. They may as well, they basically have the same power to weight ratio. Again, it's not as fast, 46 kilometers per hour top speed versus the Panther 2's 55, but it does turn slightly faster, although it's only slightly faster, 2 degrees per second, 38 versus 36. And again, the turret turns faster, 32 versus 30. So it does have a slight edge of maneuverability over the Panther 2, and having almost exactly the same power to weight ratio. The armor, of course, is garbage. I mean, the Panther 2 isn't a particularly well-armored machine anyway. It's got 20mm less armor at the front, 10 less at the side, the same 40 at the rear, and the turrets are exactly the same. Again, terrible signal range, exactly the same view range. But the difference is in the gun. Now, technically, these two tanks, the Panther 88, which is there, and the Panther 2, which is there, technically have the same gun. The KWK-43L71, which was the 88mm gun that actually saw service on the Tiger 2. However, and this is the bizarre thing, it's actually way better on the Panther 88 than it is on the Panther 2. They both fire the same shell, and I've pulled up the wrong stats. Let's get it right, Jingles. Here we go. Oh, I don't know if you caught that. It's very windy outside. I hope it's not picking it up on the microphone, but if it is, eh, tough. So, yeah, they both fire exactly the same shell, so the penetration and the damage are exactly the same. 203mm of penetration, 240 average damage. But the Panther 88 has a better rate of fire, 8.7 rounds per minute. It is more accurate, 0.32, and it aims faster, 2.5. And it was that 2.7 second aiming time which was the real killer on the Panther 2. The 88 was a good gun, but you just spent too long pointing at the enemy, getting fired back at. That's really what killed the Panther 2 for me. And 2.5 seconds isn't fantastic, but it's better, and it's also more accurate, and it fires faster. So you've got this really weird combination here on the Panther 88, with basically you have the Tier 7 Panther, but not quite as good, with the Tier 8 Panther 2's gun, but better. It's the most bizarre combination of stats I think I've ever seen on a tank in World of Tanks. Now, before we get too carried away about the gun, and it is a good gun, remember this thing does not get premium matchmaking. It's a Tier 8 premium medium tank that will get into Tier 10 games. And 203mm of penetration, well, it's not bad, but what are you going to compare it to? Let's have a look at some other Tier 8 medium tanks. Like, for example, the Centurion, with its £20 a gun that has 226mm of penetration. Or we can stay German and have a look at the Indian Panzer, with its 90mm gun. And it's 212mm of penetration, 259 with APCR. Yeah, that 203mm of pen is not that good. Premium ammunition? APCR. But this premium APCR is not fantastic either. You only get an extra 34mm of penetration with the APCR. So this thing is going to suffer in Tier 10 matches. And I don't understand why it gets into Tier 10 games. Let me show you another tank. Another tank that has a comparable, in fact a better gun. In fact, it's a better all-round tank. And it does get premium matchmaking. It's another Tier 8 premium. Where are we? Here we go. Just pull up the vehicle details for the Panther 88 so we can compare it directly. We're looking here at a French Tier 8 premium heavy tank, the FCM50T. Get a load of this. It's heavier, but it has a it has almost double the engine power, so it's faster, it turns faster, it's got better armor everywhere. Look at this. It's got a better turret traverse. The rate of fire isn't quite as good. It's got a better view range. It's got a better signal range. And check out the gun. Look at this. There we go. That 90mm gun, that's better penetration. Substantially better penetration with APCR ammo. The rate of fire isn't quite as good, but it's still 8 rounds per minute or better. It's not quite as accurate, but it's got a way better aiming time. It's just a better all-round tank. The FCM50T, also a Tier 8 premium tank. And this thing will never see Tier 10s. What's going on? This just doesn't make any sense. This is a better tank than the Panther 88 in almost every respect. And it gets limited matchmaking. The Panther 88, which is effectively a Tier 7 tank with a Tier 8 medium tanks gun, is getting into Tier 10 matches. It makes no sense whatsoever. So it's very, very difficult for me to recommend spending that amount of money on the Panther 88 because of the matchmaking that it gets. And in fact, the very first game I had in this thing was a Tier 10 match. And I think the second game I had in it was a Tier 10 match as well. And yet, I did really well in this tank. I do like this machine. And I realise that's setting all kinds of people's alarm bells ringing, because I am famous for liking bad tanks. You know, I love the TOG. It's a terrible tank, but I think it's fantastic. That does not mean that the Panther 88 is a bad tank. I really don't know what to say about it. I have had not that many games, because it's a very, very new tank, and I haven't been playing that much, but I have had some great games in this tank. Didn't win them all. Did a lot of damage. And yet, I still, despite the good times I've had with this tank, I really do hesitate to recommend it, because it is basically a Tier 7 tank with a good gun that gets into the kind of matches that it has no business being in. So I'll show you the sort of thing I'm talking about. This is the very first game that I played in the Panther 88. I'm platooned up with Circumflexes. This was the last night of World of Tanks live streaming I did before taking the Christmas break. He'd just gotten himself a Panther 88. I'd just gotten the Panther 88. We said, let's have a go. What's the worst that could happen? Well, this was the worst that could happen. Look at that matchmaking. Well, it could have been worse. Not much worse. We saw the team lists on both sides and we just thought, oh, great. But let's see what we can do. So Tier 10s and 9s everywhere. There's a fair number of Tier 8s on both teams, which was good because I do spend a lot of time shooting at the other Tier 8s in this match. But it wasn't until after watching the replays, I didn't actually realise at the time, but it wasn't until after watching the replays of these tanks in action that I realised something very, very good about this tank. It appears to have a fantastic camo rating, and I'll demonstrate that in a moment. So we're here on Northwest, and as you can see, Tier 10s everywhere. There's an E5 over there. I don't quite have a shot at him. But down below, there's a couple of Tier 8s. So here we go. Poking out from around the corner. There's one. And I just couldn't get the second shot into him. No, it missed. So he gets away. But down below, there's a T-34. I'm using my E-50M crew in my Panther 88. Remember, it's a premium tank, so I can put any German medium tank crew in it with no penalty whatsoever. And there's an Indian Panzer. So these are all Tier 8s that I'm shooting at so far. You'll note Sixth Sense has not gone off. I have not been spotted. Camo rating seems to be pretty good. And the gun performance, and look at this lot. And that AMX 5120, now he does get spotted, and that is me taking a hit for the AMX 5120 behind me, so I'm going to clear out of there. But my Sixth Sense did not go off at all during all of that. This tank did not get spotted. I took a hit, but it wasn't aimed at me. It was aimed at the AMX5120 behind me. Now, one of the things that's working in the replay but wasn't working at the time the match was played was the last reported position of enemy tanks on the minimap. This is one of the new features that's included in patch 9.5. Once a tank has dropped off the map, his last reported position still stays on the map. Now, I didn't have that turned on at the time the game was played, although you can see it in the replay. So that is actually going to get me killed later on. But for now, myself and Circon have gone down and around, and we're taking pot shots at these guys from the flank, and I've got a shot at the IS-3. Bingo. We've been spotted, however. Back up. T-34, and I'm shouting to Circon, pull back. T-34 on his left. He heard me. He backed up in time. The T-34 missed. I'm looking for a shot at that T-34. Myself and Circon are getting some hard cover between us and those guys up in front. For some reason, I thought that that IS-4... was down there, but he's obviously way over on the other side of the map. T-34 takes a shot at the Centurion to my left, and then the IS-3 has come around and he's going for Circon, so back up, look for the shot, bingo, got him. T-34 has rolled out. There's no time, I need to get down, get under his gun, get some solid cover between me and him. Gun does kind of let me down a little here. No idea where that shot went. I take a hit, but I am guaranteed to beat the T-34's reload. It's got a very powerful gun, but it's got a very, very long reload. Don't have a direct shot. Fire through the barricade. Bingo, took him out. Okay, T-34 dealt with. Jagdpanzer E-100 up in front. Looks like you could use some assistance. So I'm going to move forward and try to take some of the pressure off him. Now, keeping an eye on the map, the enemy convoy is about to pop up. And I didn't notice the convoy popping up at the time. And because I didn't have last reported position of enemy tank enabled, that's going to cost me. I'm coming around to try to assist this Jagdpanzer E-100, and oh, look at these shots. I could have just stayed here shooting at this IS-7 all day. But then I take a big old hit from the convoy. I can't hang around, but I put a final shot in at the T-57 Heavy, track him, do some damage, and I've got to pull back. I've been hit by the convoy once, I cannot afford to get hit again. No idea where he is. He dropped off the map just as he fired, so I took the hit. I'm looking at the map to see what the hell shot at me. There's nothing there. And now there's another IS-7 popped up. The Jagdpanzer E-100 is screwed at this point. I am certainly not going to try to take on an IS-7 from the front with a gun that only does 203mm of penetration. And because I didn't have last reported position of enemy tanks, although knowing from roughly which direction the shot came from, I really should have known better anyway, but I pop out to take a shot at this T-34, get a hit in, pull back, T-34 is fired and missed, I pop out to get the second shot. Of course, that is exactly the direction in which the convoy shot at me the first time. He was just sitting there waiting for me to pop out again. And that's game over. And unfortunately, our tier 10s did not have a particularly good game, so that, sadly, was a loss. Now, unfortunately, because I quit out of this game before the end of the battle, there's no results screen to show you, but that was 1,000 experience, Confederate, 3,000 damage done, and about 1,500 spotting damage on a defeat, which isn't bad for what's effectively a tier 7 medium tank in a tier 10 game. And when you're in that kind of tank, in that kind of match, there's only so much carrying you can do. Unfortunately, if you're tier 10s, like for example, T110E5, who, there he is, was the last one to die, only did 234 damage the entire game. Our next game, however, was a hell of a lot more generous, and we were joined by Thayer. There he is. He doesn't have the Panther 88, so instead, he jumped into the STA-1, Japanese tier 8 medium tank. And I do like the STA-1. Come to think of it, the STA-1 and the Panther 88 are broadly similar tanks. They both have terrible armour. The STA-1 does have the edge in manoeuvrability and speed. The Panther 88 has a slightly better gun. One distinct advantage that the STA-1 would have had in this kind of position is much, much better gun depression. Now, the Panther 88's gun depression isn't particularly bad, but it's not particularly good either, and it's going to get me into trouble here. Now, I'm thinking to myself, well, I've got a fantastic gun, I've got terrible armour, so I'm going to, at least at first, play the thing as a sniper. The traditional role that people tend to adopt when they're driving Panthers. Oop, sorry, Mr. Chaffee. Didn't mean to bump into you there, just trying to get around. And you're going to see just how far over this ridge I have to drive this tank in order to be able to point the gun down at the IS who's in the cap circle. See how bad, well, it's not, again, it's not bad gun depression, but it's not good either. And I've been spotted, and nope. And I'm just waiting to get artillery, because I've been here before and I know how this works. So I'm getting my ass behind this rock before that Hummel feasts on my tears. And it's a pretty slow start to the game, I have to admit. Oh, looks like somebody on the platoon's managed to get some shots into this. And that's where I should have been by now. I've wasted far too much time dicking around over here when I should have been getting stuck in. But I'm trying to play it as a sniper, and there he is. Oh, yeah. You can see how far I have to drive over that ridge. Somebody takes a shot at me and misses. Always satisfying when that happens. And I really need to get up there. Up into the top northwest corner of the map with the rest. I mean, yeah, all right, my armor's terrible, but I am still a top tier tank. And the rest of the platoon. Oh, here we go. Watch this. Unbelievable. Bounced off a Panther M10. I think that's the first time in recorded history that's ever happened. My second shot, however, I am pretty sure connected. And in fact, checking the post-match stats afterwards, it did in fact hit him. So some damage done, even if it's not immediately apparent. And I've got to get up here, where I really probably should have been, because trying to play the thing as a sniper at the start, especially on a map like El Haluf, is not a terrible idea. But there have to be tanks to shoot at, otherwise you're just wasting your time. And I am a top-tier tank. Crappy armor or not, my team needs me up here. So I'm moving up to attempt to support the rest of the guys in my platoon, and managed to cross the open ground without getting shot at. And oh crap, suddenly a wild Carnarvon appears. Now, 20 pounder gun versus 88. I fire and bounce, he fires and hits. But look at that reload. That is a really, really good reload. Now, the 20 pounder gun on the Carnarvon is no slouch either. I, however, have a hell of a lot more health to play with than he does, but I don't want to just throw my health away. So he's taken hits from the other side, and I've angled the tank. All you can get shots at from there is my tracks, and it's doing no damage, and I wasn't going anywhere anyway. I'm just putting shot after shot into his turret ring. Bingo, nailed myself a Carnarvon. So good start. Now let's see what shots I can get at these guys around the other side. And there's an AMX 5100. Get a shot into him. They've obviously spotted me, they know I'm here. There's that Panther M10 again. That's more like it. And he's gone, and oh crap, a full health T-34. This is not good. However, I don't have to fight him. T-34 is totally YOLO'd here. He should never have come out this far without the rest of his team. And all I have to do is just wait. There it is. I don't have to go out there and face him. He's now turned his gun around to deal with all the rest of my team who've popped up behind him because he came too far forward ahead of the rest of his tanks. Use this dead Carnarvon as cover. Get some more shots into him. Enemy Centurion has popped up. He's aiming at me. Oh, took a hit. Fire on the move and hit the Centurion. The 20 pounder on the Centurion and the long 88 on the Panther 88 are very, very similar guns. With the 20 pounder obviously having slightly better penetration. I'm going to go around here. See if I can. Oh, hello, Mr. Chaffee. We both had the same idea. Unfortunately, you were in a Chaffee. And somebody's taken pot shots at me there, but I managed to get around in cover. The AMX 5100 blows my tracks off. And that's when the T69 on the other side of the map starts having a field day with me. He's probably thinking, oh, yes, a tank I can actually penetrate. And he hits me multiple times. Tiger takes a shot and misses. Now, we've killed the Centurion, we've killed the AMX 5100. The Tiger fires and bounces, and we say, okay, we're going to go for it. We're going to rush the Tiger. We've decided at this point we're going to rush the Tiger. And if we had all rushed the Tiger, we might have gotten away with this. Unfortunately, somebody shouts out, T69 behind us, and we freeze. And that is pretty much what costs us. Well, not the game, but this encounter. I have the most health. I go forward and take the first hit from the Tiger. I can probably afford to take one more. I do take one more, but again, we're worrying about too many different tanks at the same time. Circumflexus takes a hit. We're now both one-shot kills, and then bang. I have no idea where that SU-12244 came from, but right place, right time. Fantastic decision. He nails Circumflexus. I know I'm doomed. I'm just trying to get some more damage in here. Trying to use this dead tank as cover before the Tiger comes out from behind me. SU-12244 fires, misses. I bounce. The Tiger finishes me off. We just got outplayed. We hesitated. We decided we were going to go for the Tiger, and then we didn't do it. And that pretty much cost all three of us our tanks. Now, at this point, I was convinced that we'd lost. I mean, we just played a tier 10 match in these tanks and done 3,000 damage and lost. And those are the rules. You know, if I do a lot of damage in a game and have a good game, we have to lose. I'm not allowed to win if I've done well. You know, I don't make the rules. I just work here. So I was convinced that this was going to be yet another loss. And when you see what our KV-4 is doing, here he is, you will not believe. The live stream were pissing themselves laughing at the antics of this KV-4 driver. Initially, I thought he must have been a bot, but bots would have been better. I'm not exaggerating, okay? Just you watch, right? You don't believe me? Watch what this guy does. He's just driven all the way across the map, and he finally makes it up to the top of the hill. He's in a full health KV-4. Oh my god, it's a Tiger! I'd better run away. What are you doing? It's only a Tiger. He's dead in 2-3 hits at the most. So he backs off down the hill. Remember, there's the SU-12244 out there somewhere. And, well, if you've just backed up and you start taking shots in the side, you should probably move forward. No, no, I'm going to move backward and take even more hits from the SU-12244. Oh my god, what are you doing? He was on full health less than a minute ago. Just, and the 12244 was clearly firing heat at him. The friendly SU-152 has killed the Tiger for him. And you can't really blame the SU-12244 for firing heat in these sort of circumstances. It's a KV-4. And he needs to kill him, or he's probably going to lose the game. And it's bloody obvious where he is, judging by, one, where the shots were coming from, and two, somebody's capping. He's there in the cap circle. And this clown keeps giving him the side of his turret. It's a miracle he hasn't been shot again. I don't know what he's expecting to find over here, because the SU-12244 is obviously in the cap circle. Oh, there's the T69. Well, he's there. There you go. There's the T69. He clearly isn't the one who is capping it. Oh my god, there he is. What are you doing? No, he's there. You just saw him. Where are you going? Turn your tank around. Your strongest armor is at the front. Oh, finally. And he should have died here. He absolutely 100% should have died. And the SU-12244's gun just starts trolling him. And he just can't hit him from here on in. He just misses and misses and misses. And, well, it was a win. We didn't deserve it, but it was a win. So I won't make you watch the rest of this. The KV-4 is just, oh. One day, he's going to be driving an IS-7. And he's going to be on your team. I do apologise, by the way, for the loss of any brain cells that you may have suffered after watching that KV-4 herpa-derp his way around El Halif, but it was amusing. And I seem to be collecting a lot of Confederate badges in the Panther 88. I got Confederate in the first game I played, the Tier 10 match on Northwest, and I got Confederate once again on El Halif. And Tier 8 game, Tier 10 game, managed to do more or less the same amount of damage in both matches. Pretty much all three of us in the platoon did around or more than 3,000 damage in that match, despite dying relatively early on. And, you know, that seems to be the thing about the Panther 88. It's a very, very consistent damage dealer. It's all about that 88mm gun. The rest of the tank, well, the rest of the tank isn't bad. It's reasonably mobile. It just has absolutely no armour whatsoever. Have a look at the detailed results. That was a 100,000 credit gain, by the way. Again, premium tier 8 tanks, they make a lot of money, but the Panther 88 in particular makes a lot of money because it only costs 252 credits every time you pull the trigger. This 88mm ammunition is cheap as chips. Yag Tiger 88 drivers will know exactly what I'm talking about. That thing is a credit earning monster as well. That 88mm gun is just a license to print money. The longer you can keep that gun firing, the more money you're going to make. It's as simple as that. The gun is just designed to earn credits. That's what it does. And just to give you an example of the sort of thing I'm talking about, final replay of this review, here's Mario driving the Panther 88 in a Tier 9 match on Westfield. Gentlemen, start your engines. Mario here, I say it's a Tier 9 match, there's only two Tier 9s on each side. The enemy have got a Yag Tiger, that's going to be nasty. And he's starting off, well, medium tank spawn down in the valley, himself and this Type 59. Heading up the hillside, trying to get some shots across the valley, and also to be in a position. It's a good, the middle of the map is a good spot to be here, because it gives you options. You can move north, you can move east, you can move west, depending on what happens on the map. And the mobility of the Panther 88 isn't that bad at all. I mean, despite the fact that it is heavier than a standard Tier 7 Panther, and it doesn't have as powerful an engine, it's going to suffer going up hills. But once he's up here, well, it's plain sailing. Enemy light tank spotted. That's pretty much it so far. And this is a good spot. This is actually a very, very good spot for this tank. Initially, he's going to set up as a sniper. And he takes... what's this? Didn't see an explosion. Means he probably hit something. And everybody's pummeling that bush. And, yep, there was something there. Did you see the tree falling? Somebody was in that bush. Somebody got the fright of their lives as they started taking hits, even though nobody was spotted. And they backed the hell up and then rushed down the other side of the hill. It is a bit of an obvious spot. There's always somebody in that bush. You really don't need to get spotted to get hit if you're in that position. And this is what I'm talking about. Center of the map, tank like this, ideal position. You've got options, you can go either way, depending on what you see happening. Oh, KV-3. Amongst other things. Has he been spotted? He has been spotted. Backs up. Stops to take another shot at the KV-3. It doesn't look like the KV-3 has seen him, which seems... oh, he took a big, 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 big hit there. In fact, I think he took a couple of big hits. He's lost a lot of health, but look at how accurate this gun is. AT-15, 20-pounder gun. 20-pounder gun and the Long 88, very, very similar guns. 20-pounder, better accuracy. 88, better rate of fire. 20-pounder, better aiming time. 88, slightly better alpha damage. Slightly better alpha damage and a better rate of fire. You know, I'm a big fan of the 20-pounder guns and the British tanks and tank destroyers, but I think I might be leaning towards this Long 88. Oh, there's the Yag Tiger. Oh, that's it. Christmas just arrived. Get a load of this. Side shots on a Yag Tiger. And he's tracked him, so that's just cost him 3,000 credits. Or possibly 20,000 credits if he's using a premium repair kit. And he just can't run away fast enough. The reload on this gun. Look at the damage he's done to this Yag Tiger. That's it. He's made money. He could stop playing now, lose the game, and he's still going to make a healthy profit on this tank. All of that damage against the Tier 9, he's already made money on this game. He doesn't have to do anything else now, and he's laughing all the way to the bank. Of course, he is far from finished. There's plenty more damage to be done. So, the Yag Tiger's gone all Didi Mao. And he's done a brave Sir Robin and run off. That still leaves the AT-15 up there, and there's an SU-152 lurking around somewhere as well. Also a Super Pershing, right on the far end of the field, just lurking around. There he is, over in that direction. So can't really cross around the field through the open and come up behind the enemy heavy tanks that are just over that ridge. There they are. doesn't have an awful lot of concealment against the guys over on his right flank. So what cover he has, he's going to have to use intelligently. Oh, there they are. They're on the other side of the hill. They're engaging the guys who are approaching from the cap circle on the other side, so he doesn't have to worry about them. Now, there's still an AT-15 in the woods at the back there, and he's been spotted, and there's the AT-15. But the AT-15's pointing his gun the other way. So he gets one shot into the side of the AT-15. Is he going to get a second one? AT-15's turning. No. No. Oh well. One will have to do, but the AT-15 is pulled right back down the other side of that ridge, so he doesn't have a shot at Mario's Panther. Mario's going to take the opportunity to pop over with his fast reload, plant one into the enemy tanks there. AT-15 pops back up again, but no, the AT-15 is now firing down into the cap circle as well. So with the AT-15 occupied, the Tiger II is now alone. He's going to go for it. Time to do a bit of some of that medium tank stuff. And this is the moment where... Oh, what? That could have been very, very nasty. When you pull something like that in a medium tank, that's when you want the rest of your team to step up. As soon as that turret starts swinging around, that's when you want the rest of your team to step up and punish him for taking his eye off the ball. And they did. And it bounced. And Mario probably thought there was some pain incoming there. But possibly Tiger 2. I don't know, the Tiger 2 has a long reload, but it reloads faster than that. He must have had a dead loader or a damaged ammo rack or something like that. So Mario could have taken some damage there, but he did the right thing at the right time. And his team did the right thing as well. They saw him going for it, and they came up and over the ridge, and they started putting shots into the Tiger 2, right into his side. And of course, they all bounced. You couldn't make it up. Right, okay, what have they got left? They've got a Yak Tiger, Super Pershing, a Rheinmetall Borsig, and an SU-101. And once again, check out the camera rating of the Panther 88. He's behind a bush, but he's going to lose all but something like 15% of that bush's camera rating every time he fires, and he still doesn't get spotted. The Super Pershing's pointing the gun this way, but he's shooting at the Tiger II next to him. He's not shooting at Mario. Mario has not been spotted all the while he's doing this. Now, I don't know if that means that the Super Pershing's optics are damaged or his commander is dead. There could be any number of factors that are influencing the range at which this tank gets detected. But I am consistently seeing, in replay after replay, Panther 88s just being able to keep firing through concealment in situations where other machines would get spotted, and yet the Panther 88 just doesn't. I think this tank has a ridiculously overpowered camera rating. I think he's found the Yak Tiger. And I think, well, the Yak Tiger went down fighting. But can you guess how much damage he's actually done in this game with this 88mm gun? Average of 240 damage per shot. And he's, well, by the end of the match, he's fired over 30 shots. Still, two tank destroyers. Oh, there's one. Puts one shot into the SU-101. And he's getting hit from all kinds of different directions. There's a second shot. Somebody else is going to get the kill. That just leaves the Rheinmetall Borsig. Very, very sneaky machine. Could be dangerous trying to find him. Oh, there he is. There's one. And he's ducked into cover from the rest of Mario's team, which means Mario's going to get a kill. And there's two. And that is game over. And in that game, on top of his ace tanker and his high caliber, oh look, another Confederate medal. I think I see a pattern developing here. He also earned over 153,000 credits and 2,600 experience. And his total damage done, over 5,000. Now, you might be tempted from looking at the amount of damage that he did and the amount of damage that, well, everybody else did, and thinking, wow, he totally carried that team. Well, he kind of did, and he kind of didn't. He certainly did the lion's share of damage, but he was only able to do that because his team were keeping the enemy tanks occupied, shooting at things that weren't him. As soon as he started getting shot at, he started taking damage. And from that point on, he had to play very, very cautiously, making the maximum use of cover, concealment, and terrain in order to not be shot at. This is a tank that can do very, very well indeed, as long as the rest of your team has at least the faintest idea of what they're doing. You do need your team to at least be capable of pulling its own weight, even if they don't play exceptionally well. You have to be able to survive long enough to keep this gun firing long enough to do that kind of damage, and if your team are dying all around you, it's just not possible to do that. You know, even though they're two completely different machines, in that respect, it's a lot like the E25. You often see E25 games where they do absolutely monstrous amounts of damage, just shooting from cover, undetected, keeping the gun firing, and doing thousands and thousands of damage in a game. The Panther 88 is just like that. But they're only able to do that at the expense of the rest of their team. You need your team to stay alive and stay in the game long enough for you to put the gun to work and get away with taking those shots. The second you get spotted and become the focus of enemy attention, life gets very, very serious indeed when you're driving one of these tanks. It's not like the IS-6 that has the armor to be able to carry a tough situation. This thing can't do that. And it's not even as mobile as the E25. The E25 on a big enough, open enough map, if it gets spotted and it has the space to maneuver, can at least run away, re-stealth, and try to keep fighting withdrawal. The Panther 88 can't do that. It doesn't have that kind of mobility. This is a tank that comes with a lot of strings attached. Don't forget, it gets into tier 10 games, and that 88mm gun, while I have been singing its praises all the way through this video, that 88mm gun is hot stuff at tier 8, it's not bad at tier 9, it's not that good at all at tier 10. This tank gets into tier 10 games. The FCM50T does not get into tier 10 games, and yet the FCM50T is faster, more manoeuvrable, has better armour, and the gun is as good. Yeah. Wargaming logic. I don't get it either, and yet it is what it is. You will get into games driving the Panther 88 where you cannot carry if your team starts falling apart around you because it just doesn't have the armor. The second this thing becomes the focus of enemy fire, absolutely everything that this thing gets matched up against can penetrate this tank from just about any angle. If that is not a problem for you, then this tank is worth getting, because it is always going to make money. It is a fantastic money-making machine. Mario's game, with a premium account, made 130,000 credits profit. With a standard account, he would have still made 80,000 credits profit in this tank. You will never lose money driving this tank. It is one of the best money-makers in World of Tanks. If that's all you're interested in, this is definitely worth the money. On the other hand, if you want a tank that is consistently going to win you matches, if you're any good, you should probably shop elsewhere. And I think that's probably the fairest thing I can say about the Panther 88. I have had fun driving it. I certainly do not regret owning it. You can make your own mind up based on what you've seen throughout the course of this video. If earning money is all that you're interested in, then by all means, get a Panther 88. But if you want to earn money and win games, when your team is failing all around you, you should probably shop elsewhere. Hope you enjoyed the video, folks. Have a happy new year, and I'll catch you next time.